So I will simply set the stage of the panel discussion. I will not go to the details of the panel discussion and the role of the private sector, but I will give you an overview or background information of the current national development plan. As everybody knows, for the first time, Somaliland has developed its national vision in 2012, which we call 2030 vision. And that vision actually stipulates or sets out how Somaliland should look like in the year of 2030. Based on that national vision, Ministry of National Development and Ministry of National Planning and Development was actually, leading the process of developing a five-year national development plan that has to translate the national vision into action. So for the first time, Somaliland has developed a five-year national development plan, which is supposed to last in 2012 up to 2016. In 2014, Somaliland has also developed six regional development plans in regional level. In sector level, the national development plan consists of nine sectors. It consists of five pillars and nine sectors. Therefore, the sectors have also developed a five-year strategic sector plan, which is also in line with the national development plan. In 2013, there has been a framework in which Somaliland government and the international community are supposed to work together, which is Somaliland Special Arrangement. And Somaliland Special Arrangement is part of the New Deal program, and as well as, a distinct and separate part of the Somali Compact. Therefore, the five-year national development plan, the five-year sector strategic plans, the regional development plans are coming to an end in this year, 2016. That means Somaliland is at the end of its first national planning cycle. Therefore, the question is, since we are at the end of the first national planning cycle, what should come next? What should come next is to prepare another five-year national development plan, as well as sector strategic plans and regional development plans. And to do that, we have asked ourselves, where should we start? When we are answering this question, we are not reinventing the wheel. There is a best practice across the world. So the starting point is to review, evaluate, and assess the current national development plan and the other plans. We have reviewed the current national development plan. There has been two different review exercises. One of these review exercises was very external. It has been done by Tana consultancy firm, thanks to the leader. The leader has supported it. And actually the reason why we have had an external review is to have impartial review and impartial assessment of our national development plan, so that we can have a credible assessment that all the stakeholders, can trust. Ministry of National Planning and Development has also conducted a review on the national development plan as well as the regional development plans. These two reports are available in the website of the Ministry of National Planning and Development. Based on the recommendations and the lessons learned in the past, we have developed a roadmap, which is a strategic step-by-step guideline of the preparation process of the upcoming five-year national development plan. So that roadmap sets out the process that has to be followed. I don't want to actually go into the details, but I will touch upon, the phases that the roadmap has to actually undergo. We have four main stages of the preparation process of the upcoming five-year national development plan. The first phase is to orientate and educate all the stakeholders. These stakeholders are the government in one side, the development partners, the private sector, the civil society, and the diaspora. So we have to sit down with all these different stakeholders, explain the roadmap, make clear the role of each and every stakeholder, and how the national development plan preparation process will actually, continue or proceed. The second stage, or the second phase of the roadmap, is to conduct macroeconomic and sector analysis. We have to undertake macroeconomic analysis because we have to understand the macroeconomic outlook of the country. If we have to prepare a robust and evidence-based national development plan, we have to first understand the realities on the ground in terms of macro level. So we have to look at the overall picture of the macroeconomic variables of the country, such as inflation, unemployment, balance of payment, poverty profile, and so on, the macroeconomic variables. And based on that, we have to also make a sector analysis. We have 9 sectors, as I have mentioned it, and we have to conduct a situation analysis in each sector so that we can understand what the reality is out there. And based on the analysis of the macroeconomy as well as the sector level, then we have to set out the goals, the priorities, the strategic objectives, and indicators of the upcoming 5 years. And then we have to officially draft the document, validate it, and then release. The reason why we are undergoing all this process is to have an evidence-based, inclusive, and participatory national development plan that can actually, you know, rely on the ownership of all the stakeholders. Therefore, the private sector is one of the key stakeholders of the National Development Plan, both the current one and the upcoming one. But the message that we would like to convey from here to you is we need the private sector engagement into the National Development Plan preparation process and its, you know, implementation as well to be strengthened and promoted. So I will end up there. As Abdikarim mentioned it, and the different presentations and talking points of the different delegates have already highlighted, Somaliland economy is driven by the private sector, I can say. Because if you refer the World Bank survey in 2013, it clearly mentions that more than 90% of the country's GDP is contributed by the private sector. The government contributes less than 10%. That means Somaliland economy is driven and led by the private sector. Private sector contribution is actually all across the board. One of the key examples that they can put in place or that they can actually take is the role of the private sector in job creation. Private sector is the biggest employer, just like other countries. One of the major obstacles of Somaliland's economy and Somaliland's development is, you know, the incredibly high unemployment rate. Private sector is contributing a lot to solve that problem. So that means the private sector is directly contributing to the goals and objectives of the national vision and the national development plan. One of the biggest challenges in which Somaliland is currently facing and will face in the future as well is the poverty. If you look at the World Bank survey, the World Bank household survey, the poverty rate in the urban areas is 29%. The poverty rate in rural areas is 38%. If you look at the contribution of the private sector in poverty reduction, I can argue, or we can argue, that the private sector contributes a lot in reducing the poverty. They contribute in the way that private sector provides financial inclusion to the citizens of the country, to the citizens of Somaliland. As it has been mentioned, Somaliland people are very entrepreneurial people, and the private sector gives a platform that the poorer and low-class people can join into the market and then, you know, actually undertake income generation activities. Private sector also contributes to the primary social services, which is the first responsibility of the government to the citizens. They contribute the health, they contribute education, they contribute electricity or the energy sector. So in general, I can say the private sector is also actually contributing to increasing access of education, to providing primary healthcare to the society of Somaliland or to the community of Somaliland. And they are the one who is actually leading the energy sector or the electricity sector. If you take other life examples, which is very key for the development of the country, look at the telecommunication sector, which is very key for the development of any nation. Look at, for example, the remittance, look at the commercial banks. All these are key sectors for the development of the country. They contribute job creation, they contribute poverty reduction, they contribute creating an environment that Somaliland can be well connected to the entire of the world. So I can say private sector is the heart of the country. It's the heart of the economies of the economy of the country. But I can argue the role of the private sector could have been more than that. It could have been more than that, I can say. Maybe we can actually discuss in the next sessions. But I believe if we actually create an enabling environment together, if we sit down together and solve the problems and obstacles in which the private sector is currently facing, and if we actually try to make some sort of attitudinal change in the private sector, the private sector can contribute more than that. So I will pass the microphone to my colleague.
I'll give to Gole. So please, if you emphasize the contribution of the actual plan from the private sector, an input for the MDB1 from the private sector, yeah, if we go to the MDB2.
Yeah. In terms of the National Development Plan 1, I think Mubarak was has already mentioned that the private sector is very important for the economy of the country. But in looking at the National Development Plan, and especially because we have these sector coordination groups, we could have had more participation of the private sector in these sector coordination groups. These groups are for all stakeholders working in the country, and because the private sector is acting in all the sectors, it's really, really important to have them participating in these forums, in these discussion groups. If I can mention some of the things that the private sector worked very well with the government, I think the economic sector is one sector that is really making progress and passing some reforms, discussions. So this is, I think, is one of the lessons we can learn from the National Development Plan 1 and to use in the National Development Plan 2. If you can create this sort of a dialogue in the other sectors, this is very, very important, because then you are bringing people from different perspectives, the government, the private sector, and NGOs and developing partners as well, to discuss and shape.
You can't talk about private sector contribution without mentioning Telesom or the Telesom group, which I represent today. As you all know, it's almost needless to say that Telesom has contributed to the society's development, maybe even more than any other private company in the country. Telesom, the telecommunication company, has brought telephone and internet to every corner of Somaliland, from city to rural areas, and has provided a technological foundation for sales and communication. And this has benefited the society in a tremendous way. I also have to mention SAD, which all of you are familiar with. It is the payment system that enables customers to purchase everything through their mobile phones. And this had made easier for the customers and for businesses to receive payments, and therefore have developed the country's private sector. And this is the reason why Bill Gates, the founder of Microsoft, for several occasions, has praised Telesom for this service and the huge contribution it has made for the country's development. The obstacles is that the private sector, which basically or mostly is driven by profit motives, I think an obstacle is to make the companies understand its role in society and make them look into ways that they can contribute to the social development. And they can start by ensuring that their employees is given their rights, and they can start by developing company policies that ensure a friendly working environment. As a representative for also Dar es Salaam Bank, I need to mention a couple of things that Dar es Salaam has done to achieve the visions which is stated in the National Vision Plan. The main role of a bank in society is to provide financial services to help people and businesses to achieve their goals and reach their potentials. Therefore, Dar es Salaam has acted or been a really important investment link in investing in new businesses and also all businesses that needs to expand. Dar es Salaam Bank has contributed by giving loans, granting loans, and have several services that has helped businesses grow. I also need to mention the TT service, which has enabled businesses to purchase goods outside the country and use the TT service to transfer money to the seller's bank account outside of Somaliland. This has enhanced public international trade and has made it possible for many businesses to grow, as it now is no longer necessary to travel with suitcases full of cash and travel to, for instance, China to pay for the goods that you have bought. Also, the companies in the Telesom Group has been very aware of the importance of its role in the social development of the country. The companies in the Telesom Group, of course, create jobs. There are thousands of employees in the Telesom Group. But also, let me just mention one important thing, is that the bank also contributes to the employees' well-being and social welfare by actually updating or drafting new employment conditions, giving, for example, the female employees in the company 3 months of paid maternity leave. So this is showing that it's really important to take the social responsibility role seriously. And maybe as the only company in the country, Dar es Salaam Bank has given its female employees 1 hour of nursing break so they can breastfeed their children under 1 year. And that's really, revolutionary. That shows that it's really important to abide by relevant laws, applicable laws. So the other companies in the Telesom group strive to comply with Somaliland labor law. I think I mentioned both the contribution and the obstacles.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ilham. I will give to Mohamed Liban, and mainly if you can emphasize in the obstacles of the private sector contribution, NDB1, and mainly input. If you have input for the NDB1 from the private sector, before we go to NDB2. So what was the contribution to put together that time from the private sector, NDB1? Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I think I'll break the question into two. Firstly, I'd like to also say a few words on the first question that you mentioned, which was the role of the private sector in the development plan, the national development plan. Just to briefly talk about, I'll try to stick to the financial services sector and maybe the telecommunications sector, which I know more about, you know, through the entities of our group. The national development plan has many pillars. I think the one that the private sector, especially the financial services sector, contributed towards the most would be increasing or facilitating the mobilization of the savings. You know, the minister mentioned it. It's one of the most important components of development. In order for there to be development in any country, a certain amount of the GNP or the GDP should be saved. And I think in the last 5 years that we've had the plan and the financial services sector has been growing, deposits have been growing tremendously across the board, either at the microfinance level, through the banks, smaller entities, larger entities, corporate deposits as a whole are growing. So I think that will lead to directly more investment in businesses that can then affect the bottom line or the growth of the country. So firstly, I think the financial services sector, whether it be our Dahabshil Bank or Micro Dahab, by mobilizing these scattered deposits across the country, bringing them to the private sector in a place where they can then facilitate in the selection of or the channeling of the funds towards the more important sectors or towards the sectors that we think are feasible, are going concern, can lead to more employment, can lead to more economic development. That is the most important contribution that the financial services sector have had towards the national plan. There's another pillar, the social welfare pillar. The private sector as a whole, and both, I could speak specifically to the Dahabshil group, have increased the amount of work they're doing as corporate social responsibility, whether it be giving out alms or whether it be microfinance institutions and other institutions that are made not for profit by the private sector, but because they want to give back to their community. So I think the private sector has also contributed, you know, a lot towards the social welfare of the country. If I come towards your question right now regarding the difficulties that are faced by the private sector in contributing, I would say, you know, there's a pillar already in the National Development Plan, which is the reform of the laws and making the country more business friendly. I think there's a lot of work that the government has done in the last 5 years, making business registration easier and so on and so forth. But there's a lot more that needs to be done, especially when it comes to, if I speak specifically to financial services again, when it comes to rule of law, when it comes to, especially with leasing and other products that are maybe not in urban areas, making sure that, you know, the financial services companies or the banks are able to, you know, control their assets. And specifically, if I speak towards something that Samater mentioned with the central bank, the central bank has really done a lot in the last 5 years, but I think it now needs to become a priority going forward in the next development plan. Maybe it can be a separate pillar, or I'm not entirely sure how we can do it, but there needs to be more reform and more focus by the government, by the public sector, in ensuring that the financial services companies, the private companies, have enough protection for their assets. You know, the assets of the financial service sector are basically the deposits of the public. So the fiduciary responsibility on the banks is also on the government, you know, through the central bank, to ensure that these investments that the banks are making are secure, that there's enough protection on collateral, there's enough protection on guarantees, and so on and so forth. So I think going forward, maybe that's someplace that we can put more of a focus on in the coming national development. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohamed. Dr. Mohamed, floor.
Thank you very much. I think, you know, my friend said a lot, you know, responded, but let me just follow up. I think, to be very frank, in terms of NDP 1, it was basically a public sector program, you know, that was the emphasis. And I think what we learned from that first experience is that the centrality of the private sector involvement was not there, you know. And I think because of the short time, you know, we have it, and being, you know, the first one, I think it was more on public sector sort of program. I think what is very important now is how we envisage the private sector involvement in NDP 2. See, we have, you know, at the top, you know, we have the vision. Then the vision basically is to be taken in the form of 4 or 5 year development plan program. We had the first one, there's a lesson, it's not learned. We build, you know, on that. We are moving into the second, you know, national development, you know, plan, you know, formulation. And the main difference of what is being done in here, you know, based on that experience, that the first one was substantially mirrored around activities. There was a menu of things, you know, to be done, different sectors, different, you know. Now I think we are making a slight shift now. We are looking into the vision, and then we are looking into the NDP, and then from the NDP what we are trying to look at is what are actually to undertake a very comprehensive sector analysis. And basically what we are attempting in this time is to start with emphasis to be outcome, you know, basic. And the way we want to do is for each sector we want to see where we are and where we want to go during that 4 years, and we take in the form of indicators, and we basically look into the gap and see if we are having it, you know, in any of the areas, you know, education, infrastructure, we take, you know, the appropriate sort of indicator and say that this is where we are for the coming 5 years. Instead of 12% coverage, we need to actually reach, I'd say, 18%. Now what we need is actually to translate that realistically assessed percentage where we think, you know, we can move it, you know, forward or accomplish. That has to be then translated in the form of public investment plan. That's going to be done it by the public sector as well as, you know, by the private sector. So we are envisaging, for example, like in the production, you know, sector, whether it's actually livestock, whether it's actually fisheries, whether it's actually agriculture, we have to translate that. You know, we are looking into our food security, and we'll say that in agriculture we're 11% food secure. If we are actually want to say it, we want to go it on for this on 20% food security level, that percentage we have to translate into an investment plan. That's where, you know, actually we're looking for the private sector to come in. Similarly, you know, for the service sector, in the banking, you know, similarly, you know, it will be for the infrastructure. So basically, we want to engage, you know, the private sector to really move it, you know, in a big way in the accomplishment of that public investment plan. Part of it is going to be within the public sector, but substantially, actually, it's to be lifted by the private sector. And we're foreseeing, you know, the need for a robust public-private partnership to actually sort of play a significant role in the realization, of this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Samater. And let's move to the NDB2 or National Development Plan 2. And I have a question for the private sector. What priorities should be addressed in the NDB2 so that the private sector can flourish and catalyze the development? And how these priorities will be decided, and the private sector play a role in defining these priorities? I'll give Mohamed, the NDB2, we said, the NDB1 was public driven, so how now we can change that, the NDB2, and have more role for private sector.
Thank you. So I think I might have mentioned what I think are some key priorities when I answered earlier, but I'll try to elaborate to some extent. And again, my answers will be related more towards the financial services sector, which I know more about, where I think the government can help the financial services sector prosper in the coming plan. The most important limitations, or the most critical limitations on the financial services sector, I think right now, are two, mainly. The first being the financial services sector we have in the country is Islamic finance based. And the laws that are there for, say, business laws or the commercial laws, the trade laws, and so on and so forth, and to some extent even the laws, the regulations given by the central bank, are not very conducive to being a Islamic bank. For instance, I would say the pricing that we have now is reflective of course, the country we live in, the risk and the cost of the funds that the bank uses, but it's also reflective of the tax structure we have. So the majority of the real estate or other fixed asset financing that the bank does, there is a considerable tax overlap. At times you might need to pay twice the tax for the same product, simply because the way the product is structured is not the way that the law understands a financial services product to be structured. And therefore, that burden is then driven forward, of course, to the final consumer, which makes it more expensive for the private sector to then invest in all of these sectors that might have been more productive, or there might have been more investment if the pricing was right. So I think a priority has to be reforming the tax system. I know there's some reform going on now. There are a number of projects that the government is doing with the Inland Revenue Authority. But nonetheless, in the reform of these revenue authorities or these public sector, the private sector should be involved. Because I think by involvement, I mean what we could do and what we have seen some of the parts of the government do is before a law is finalized and given to the parliament or given to the ministers, it's shared with the private sector. And not the private sector as in just the Chamber of Commerce. The Chamber of Commerce is obviously is generally the best way to get it disseminated, but to also disseminate it to maybe the biggest stakeholders in each sector, so that as a white paper before it's given to the higher authorities, so that they can give their feedback. And I know this is not, maybe it's not there yet, but not a lot of white papers have been shared on reforming the tax system with us. So I hope that maybe that's one way we can do it, by sharing these regulations or sharing these documents while they're still in the draft format with the key players in each sector. Secondly, when I leave about the tax reform and the legal reform, I think the private sector should take more of a role in educating the public on the financial services sector. Right now, I think the burden falls completely on the private sector. Because obviously, as everybody here knows, the country is just now coming out of a very difficult phase. Financial services and banking and all of these things are new to a lot of people. So a lot of people who might have been customers, who might have used a deposit, who might have deposited their funds, who might have maybe come to finance a house, will not do so because they don't understand how it works, what the structure is, what they need to do, their rights, the bank's rights, and so on and so forth. That is now completely on the private sector to do, which is very expensive to do. So I think going forward, I think the government should now, the new development plan should have a part that takes into account the government's responsibility of communicating the things that are available to the public by the private sector. Thank you.
I will give you an Ilhan follow-up. the SDG 2 and 12 from the practice.
Thank you. No? One of the visions stated in the national plan is developing a nation where justice and the rule of law prevails. Somaliland today, we can say, lacks a coherent legal system, and that's where the government contributes the most. I would say that creating a unified and robust system of law is one of the biggest challenges that we face today in society. Therefore, for the next few years, I think that the government should focus on strengthening the law, the rule of law. And that can be done by passing necessary laws. It can be done by ensuring enforcement of these laws. And it can be done by training judges. It can be done by fighting corruption in the court system. And it also can be done by building law databases, making the laws available for both the public and the companies. When it comes to the law process, the law-making process, it's really important that the government involves the private sector. As the private sector and the private companies can contribute with expertise and experience needed. For the next few years, it's important that the government have a clear, must have a reform strategy for the lawmaking process. And also, I think, what was the name again? Mohamed mentioned to involve the private companies more. In that sense, it is really important to mention one challenge that I know that Dar es Salaam Bank faces, and that the government easily could do something with. And that is when the customer applies for a loan and has a property or real estate that is want to have it as a collateral, the bank can never be sure that the documentation brought by the customer is valid. Therefore, I urge the government to develop a database where real estate files is stored and also made accessible for, example, banks in cases where the customer wants to have real estate as collateral. And the technology is in place. As you may be aware of, Telesom has recently launched a cloud solution, which I think the government can benefit from when developing the databases I've mentioned, because it enables securing and storing the files and the national archives. So the biggest challenge for the government is to really put in place the legal framework needed for the companies to succeed.
Thank you, Ilhan. And you already solved the title system for real estate for companies. That's a challenge, actually, you know, for collateral. What is flawed? Yeah.
Just if I understood your question well, your question is the sectors in which the private sector should invest or, you know, should focus on to catalyze the economic development of the country. I will try to touch upon few key sectors in which the private sector should actually address if the development of the country, you know, if you actually need, you know, to make a significant progress in the economic development of the country. Let me take energy as an example. Energy, lack of access to reliable and cheap energy is one of the key challenges of Somaliland's private sector development. The government can do something and the private sector can do something. We have huge potential deposits of coal, As mentioned by the earlier presentation, we are in one of the regions that receives the highest sun radiation, and we are located in a very windy region where we can actually produce enough cheap and reliable energy. So if the private sector invests the renewable energy, it could have been a very good solution of the challenge in which the private sector is currently facing. Even, you know, if you look at, you know, at the different studies, even Somaliland can export electricity, let alone to have enough electricity or cheap electricity, but even we can export because we have tremendous, you know, amount and potential, solar energy, and we have potential wind power energy, and we have a coal. So if the private sector invests in the renewable energy and, you know, and the coal production, that could have been a very good solution for that key challenge in which the private sector is currently facing, which is actually a very, very big detrimental for the development of the country. Because without affordable, cheap, and reliable energy, we cannot think about Somaliland to industrialize. We cannot think about Somaliland to actually make progress in terms of, you know, in terms of actually, you know, in terms of the manufacturing sector. So I would suggest the private sector to focus on to invest, you know, a large scale project is in renewable energy, and as well as, you know, extracting coal deposits of the country. One of the key sectors in which Somaliland is very potential is the marine resources. We have a long coast with very potential, you know, marine resources. And we have at the gate of a very, very big market where many landlocked countries are located, like for example, Ethiopia. So if the private sector invests, you know, the fishing sector or the fishery sector, where we have, you know, a very good comparative advantage, it could actually create more employment opportunities. It can enhance the country's balance of payment. It can actually, you know, give the government access to, you know, access to generating more revenue. So fish is very, very potential resource that we have. So instead of importing rice from Thailand, instead of importing sugar from, you know, from somewhere across the world, we need to invest the potential sectors so that we can get a solution for the key challenges in which this country is facing, like, for example, unemployment and combating with poverty reduction. And we need, for example, to actually invest the meat processing, you know, the livestock sector. For example, we can establish a meat processing factories. Instead of exporting live animals to abroad, to Saudi Arabia, we can actually create a value chain. We can add value to our livestock. We can establish meat processing factories, and then we can actually export a canned meat to Saudi Arabia and to the rest of the world. Why our private sector do not invest? And if you look at, for example, the agriculture sector, the private sector can actually invest the crop production. They can invest the poultry. They can invest in the dairy, which is very, very potential. If you look at Hargeisa today, if you look at, for example, Mansour, we actually import eggs from, for example. One of the key challenges in which the private sector is currently facing is lack of, you know, skilled and technical manpower. The reason is our education is not demand-driven. What our universities and schools produce and the labor skills that the market demands are not matching each other. We need to establish technical institutes that can produce skilled technical people. If you observe Hargeisa and other cities of Somaliland, you could see many expatriates or many foreigners who are actually, you know, handling and doing the technical work. And our people are unemployed and sitting in the tea shops at the streets. So the private sector needs to invest the technical vocational education and training, and we need to formalize that particular sector so that we can have a skilled labor force that can actually fill the gap. If you look at, for example, health, our private sector can invest the tertiary health. Our people now goes to India, goes to Ethiopia, goes to elsewhere in the world to get, you know, tertiary health service. Our private sector has the money. They need to invest the tertiary, you know, healthcare of the country. So there are a lot of potential sectors in which the private sector can actually tap huge amount of profits, which can also actually catalyze the development of the country and contribute to the realization of the national vision and the national development plan. So I would suggest the private sector to look down and actually invest the potential sectors which can contribute to the development of the country.
Thank you, and I will give you the last question for each panelist. I will start with Gole. And what mechanisms and should be in place and incentives and to be in place to capture the private role and contribution to the NDP too? So I just want to know how you give, because more incentive, the private sector to contribute more in the NDP too. I will start Gulet and then we'll go. The last question.
Yeah. I was about to ask you how much time we had, because I wanted to touch on these issues.
Yeah, five minutes. Yeah.
No, because I think like our colleague, like one of the first issues that she raised was about like the incentives. The private sector is driven by profit, and we don't ignore that, and I think it is very important. At the end of the day, if the private sector is developing, the nation is developing, so we can't really ignore this. But on the other hand, just trying like to summarize some of the issues that we were discussing here, I think like for some of the actors in the private sector, it's really, really important that some of the reforms are passed, that we really have a push on these reforms. And I think we all agree on that, especially in the financial sector. This is something very important. On the other hand, in other sectors, the exactly access to finance is so important. So we are kind of like, we have like a disimbalance balance, and that we really have like to discuss. I think one of the action points of this dialogue, it is that the dialogue should continue. And we have like the coordination sector groups like to talk about this, like to raise the issues. I think this is the priority. I think that is the priority. Let's discuss and find together a solution. The National Development Plan shouldn't be a plan of the government, shouldn't be a plan of the private sector, of the donors. It shouldn't be it should be a plan of the of Somaliland, and everybody should be you know, backing the plan. We are only going to have like this situation about everybody backing the plan if everybody participates in the discussions. One issue that I think it is very important that we are discussing here. Which are the incentives for the private sector? I think there are two, I would say three incentives. Two of them are very direct incentives, which are public-private partnerships. We had this role model, let's put it in that way, that's the Dubai, WP Dubai, Dubai World. This is a private-public partnership. We can have more, we have some like in Burao about like water. And we can discuss always like with very high levels of governance and transparency, but we can promote this. Another very direct I think incentive for the private sector is that when you participate in these kind of discussions, you really can put forward your concerns, exactly what you're doing here. Like there are some reforms that we really, really have to pass, and let's make a huge effort to pass these reforms. And I think on an indirect incentive, it's to participate in discussions, to shape the development agenda of the country, when you participate in the discussions, you know more about the opportunities that are out there. I think this is when I was just waiting like for the panel, I was looking at this very good material from the Ministry of Trade, which highlights like the opportunities in the country. There are so many opportunities in the country, and we really need like the private sector, which has been doing this work of investing in opportunities, like to continue and to expand the areas. We have needs in the health sector, education sector, all the sectors. And I really like this kind of revolution that is happening in the energy sector. And I think it is something very good that all the sectors should look at and try to you know, come up with their own ideas like to change the reality.
Samater?
Don't have much to add, but I think it's essential the dialogue forum is important. Now we have, you know, sector groups, you know, now. On top of that, I will urge within the private sector, you know, to actually create active business associations. And it will be very helpful to engage, you know, in these various, you know, sectors where there is this opportunity, is to have the dialogue to also to be with those actually business associations who are directly interested, you know, in those, you know, areas. So I just would like to urge that, you know, when you have the sector groups which you are having it, which is part mostly gravitates around the public, I would suggest that, you know, we, you know, the private sector should actually enhance, you know, and strengthen business associations, and that will be a good partner, you know, with the public sector, you know, in the various, you know, sectors, to whether it's a policy aspect of it formulation or whether it's actually association in terms of implementation of potential programs or projects. Thank you.
Ilhan, for the last word, and what incentives that the private sector can contribute to the NDB too, or mechanisms that the government should take?
I think I've already mentioned some incentives. But as I said, the legislative framework creates a foundation for the company's success. That's why it's important for the public sector, or it is the public sector's main responsibility to ensure that the legal frameworks are there. So the main incentive, as I see it, is developing relevant laws and strengthening the rule of law. And in that sense, it's really important for the public sector to involve the private sector all the way. The law reform must be made inclusive, and it must foster widespread public participation. A really important incentive is also to develop business-friendly laws that can protect both the consumers and the companies. I must say Somaliland has come a long way in passing really important laws. For example, we have a really comprehensive companies law, very comprehensive Islamic Bank Act or law that Dar es Salaam Bank is founded under. And we have an anti-money laundering bill that not yet has been passed, but is really important as it sets out the foundation for a good and responsible corporate. So I would say that the strengthening of rule of law is a main incentive.
Mohamed Liban, the last word about that topic. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I think my colleagues already mentioned maybe the most important ones. I will just add one, which is maybe for the government to take on a role of de-risking certain sectors. So for instance, if we take fisheries, for example, or any other sector, just to prove that the business case is there. You know, one of the limitations that the private sector faces is that there's not enough statistical information on the side of the market, the risks of going into that sector, or, you know, other than lack of information in itself is a barrier to entry. So maybe that acts as, you know, a limitation for the private sector going into all of these sectors that my colleagues mentioned. So maybe if the government, along with the private sector and development partners, could develop a fund that invests in these sectors as a first mover, takes on that risks with private partnership, and then exits when it proves that, you know, the sector is something that people can make money from. I think that's the limitation here. If people know that that business concept has been proven by somebody else, then generally we see in the market a lot of people follow on and then go into the market. So I think they need to take on that role. And I understand the limitations on, you know, the government's capacity for investment and their capital and their budget and all that. But nonetheless, I think that would be a good incentive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohamed. Mubarak, the last word for the panel and before we go to the break.
Just, if you allow me, I will try to touch upon key priority areas that we need actually to focus on in the upcoming 5-year national development plan. That we need actually the private sector to collaborate with us. As I have already mentioned, we actually need the upcoming national development plan to be more inclusive and more participatory. I have been part of the reviewing team of the current national development plan, and when we met with the private sector representatives, you know, the overwhelming answer that we have received from them was, we don't know about the national development plan, and even we didn't see it. So what we need to do to actually address that gap is the private sector to participate in the preparation process of the upcoming national development plan. We already gave the platform. It will be more sector-based. So the private sector needs to come on board in the sector coordination forums, where the priorities, the goals, and the objectives will be decided and will be discussed. One of the things we need to focus on in the upcoming 5-year national development plan is, I agree with my colleagues, is actually, you know, to continue to scale up the business environment and investment climate reform in which the government has actually started earlier. There is a significant progress that has been made, but we need to scale up. But to scale up, we need the private sector to be a catalyst to the government. We need the private sector to push the government to actually reform the business environment and the investment climate. One of the things that we need to focus on in the upcoming 5 years is the regulatory framework. It has been touched upon in different presentations or different few talking points. We need to actually, you know, to look at, for example, the investment law. We need to look at the Company Act. We need to actually, you know, look at the licensing procedures. Although, you know, the licensing procedure has been actually easy enough, because one-stop shop service has been established at the Ministry of Trade and Investment, but we need to actually put it in practice. One of the things we need to focus on is our economy is very, very informal. If you look at the formal private sector and the informal private sector, we can say, you know, the weight of the informal private sector can actually outweigh the formal private sector. And it is very, very difficult to come up with robust policies and strategies for an informal economy. So we need to formalize the private sector. And we need actually, you know, the private sector to collaborate with the government in formalizing the private sector and the economy. Because that is very, very, you know, key detrimental to the development of the country. One of the areas we need to focus on, I think Dr. Saad mentioned it, is actually strengthening and promoting, you know, investment promotion agencies. For example, we need to establish, or we need to advocate to establish, a separate and independent investment agency for the country that can promote the investment climate and the investment and the business environment of the country. One of the areas that we are very lagging behind is research and development. My colleague has already touched on it. the private sector could have actually take the first move of, for example, entering into these potential and frontier markets, frontier, you know, sectors. What they just you know, to actually to tap, you know, that potential market, they need to establish a very strong department or arm of research and development. The government needs to strengthen it. The private sector needs to strengthen it. Without research and development, it is actually very, very difficult to come up with, you know, to come up with a robust development. So I would suggest the private sector to strengthen their efforts of having a robust research and development. One of the areas that we need to focus is building the trust between the government and the private sector. We need to build that trust. Now it is very loose, I can argue. The private sector do not that much trust the government. So we need to build that trust. And to build that trust, we need the private sector to come on board on the platforms where the discussion is and the decision is and the priorities, you know, are decided and actually, you know, discuss it. So for example, the private sector needs to come on board like this forum on the sector coordination forums, so that the private sector and the public sector can have a direct dialogue and can solve together the problems and actually rule out, you know, and the mistrust between the government and the private sector. And, you know, lastly, we need actually to focus on these key sectors which can actually drive, you know, the economy. Like, for example, the ones that I have already mentioned, like the energy, the fisheries sector, the livestock, those sectors that we have comparative advantage. And the private sector can, actually, you know, have a lot of incentives to actually, you know, to be more engaged into the priority areas. My colleagues have already touched upon, there is already public-private partnership policy and strategy developed by Ministry of Trade and Investment. And it is one of the key incentives that the private sector can actually have to work with the government in investing the priority sectors. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mubarik. Let's thank the panel. Thank you very much.